Hello students, hope you are following all the instructions given on due to the COVID-19, that is coronavirus, and hope you are doing your assignments and mini projects time to time. Here we are discussing the topic that we have stopped from the previous lecture, that is replacement algorithms. This is one of the elements of cache design. Before this, we have discussed three different cache design elements. That is, first is cache addresses, where we have seen physical cache and logical cache. That is, logical cache addressing and physical cache addressing. The next was cache size. So what are the different cache sizes for different levels of cache, like L1, L2 and L3 cache? Then we had seen a important topic that is called as mapping functions. There are three mapping functions: direct mapping, set associative mapping, and associative mapping. And we have done the problems also based on this topic. And this is a very important topic from exam point of view. The next element of cache design is replacement algorithms. Now, once your cache is filled, with that all cache lines are filled, we need to replace the cache lines when we want to brought a new block from main memory to the cache memory. Okay, so first we'll discuss with respect of direct mapping. It says that no choice for replacement in direct mapping. Now, according to the direct mapping logic, for any block that has to be brought into the cache or that has to be mapped into the cache line, there will be only one cache line where you can map that block. Okay, so there is no choice for replacement algorithms. If you want to replace, then you have only one line from the cache that you can replace. Simply, that direct mapping says. So we cannot apply replacement algorithms to the direct mapping. Okay, so no choice for replacement in direct mapping. It says each block only maps to one line, so we have to replace that line only. Okay, now with respect of associative and set associative mapping, we have a choice of replacement algorithm. So we can apply different replacement algorithms over here. Here we have discussed four different types of replacement algorithms. There can be other replacement algorithms also. It says that when we implement this algorithm in hardware, then it boosts up the speeds. That means it can achieve a greater speed if we implement this algorithm in hardware. But in software also, you can implement this. First is least recently used, which is a very effective or very popular algorithm. That is, we call it as a LRU, as a short form. Least recently used algorithm says that replace that block in a set that has been in a cache longest with no reference. That means a particular block or a line that resides in a cache with a longer period with no reference, then we have to replace that block. For example, if you want to implement this LRU in two-way set associative cache, then it is easy to implement. In two-way set associative cache, in a particular set, we have only two cache lines. So we can use a use bit or in a particular bit that is associated with each line in that two-way set associative cache. When a particular line is referenced from the cache, we will set that bit to 1 and other cache line we set to 0. Okay. So when a replacement is to be happened with that particular set, then the line whose use bit is 0 is replaced first, and the line whose use bit is 1 is kept inside the cache. Okay, that is a least recently used. That means the line with the use bit as 0 is least recently used. That's why we have to replace that line. Next is first in first out algorithm. That is FIFO. We call it as, it is simple. It says that replace that block from the cache that has been in the cache longest. So the older block from the cache we need to replace. This FIFO algorithm can be simply implemented with the help of round robin fashion. Another is least frequently used. least frequently used says that replace that block which has had fewest hits. That means to implement this algorithm, we can maintain one kind of a counter with each line of the cache. Okay. And that counter gets updated or the counter gets incremented when a line is referenced from the cache. So least frequently used can be implemented where the line which is has a fewer count value can be replaced first, because that has not been references that has not been references from the past. Okay, so replace that block line. That is least frequently used. Another is random. Okay, all these algorithms, that is LRU, FIFO, or LFU, that is least frequently used. These are based on the usage pattern, that how much the line has been referenced, how much time, or the cache line is residing in the cache from how much time. So on that basis, this algorithm works. Another algorithm that is called as a random, that does not uses this criteria. It just says that replace any line, any randomly selected line. The result says that the random algorithm has an inferior performance than other algorithms, that is LFU, FIFO, and list means slightly inferior performance than the other algorithms. But if you consider this, the LRU is the more effective or best algorithm in terms of the hit ratios. LRU can also be implemented you can keep you can keep a kind of a queue where a particular line is referenced, then that line is brought into the front. Okay, and when you want to replace a particular line, the line from the backside is replaced. So in that manner, you can implement the least recently used algorithm, LRU. Okay, now we'll move to the write policy. That is another element of cache design, that when we want to perform a write on a cache, then that is not a simple issue that we just overwrite a particular cache line with a block from the main memory. Okay, what write policy says? When a block from the main memory has to be brought into the cache, that means when we want to overwrite a particular block from the main memory onto the cache line, then it must not overwrite a cache. It must not overwrite a cache block unless main memory is up to date. That means what happens? Say changes are made in the cache line, then that cannot be reflected into the main memory. Or if you made changes into the main memory, then that is not reflected into the cache. So write policy says that everywhere should be the updated copies of that particular word, whether you are looking into the main memory or whether you are looking into the cache memory. Okay. Another issue with the write policy is that multiple CPUs may have individual caches. That means if you are using multi-core architecture, then there are many cores or many CPUs on a single chip. Okay. And every CPU has its own local cache. Okay. Suppose a particular CPU made changes to its own local cache, but the same word is present into another CPU's cache also, then that entry of the another CPU's cache will be invalid. Okay. At the same time, the entry of the same word from the main memory is also invalid. Okay. So that's why a write policy is an important issue of cache design. Okay. Another important point is IO may address main memory directly. That means what happens? In some systems, main memory has a direct access of IO devices. So IO device can be directly access the main memory. So a word or a block can be updated by any IO devices into the main memory. Okay. Then the particular cache entry will be invalid. So that is the issue with the write policy. So whenever we want to overwrite a particular block or particular line into the cache, we need to make sure that it should be first written onto the main memory to make it updated. Otherwise, it will have an inconsistent view. So there are two techniques that we can implement with the help of write policy, that is write through and write back. First, we'll see write through. Write through. Write through says that all writes go to the main memory as well as cache. That means whenever we want to perform a write operation, then write operation should happen on the cache as well as the main memory at the same time. So write through assumes that main memory is always up to date. Okay. Whenever you have a multiple CPUs or multiple caches, then multiple CPUs can monitor main memory traffic to keep its local cache up to date. That means there is a common bus to which different CPUs or different caches are attached. Also, the main memory is attached. Then for a particular write operation on a particular main memory, the CPUs should keep monitoring the bus whether a particular write operation is happening on a particular cache and make it updated to the other caches and to the main memory so that the main memory and cache is always up to date. But write through has a particular problems, like it creates a lots of memory traffic. In write through, as you can see, that it should be updated to particular cache, it should be updated to main memory. So it has a multiple commands or multiple write operations are happening most of the times when a particular write operation is done. So it slows down the write operations. Okay. So that is the idea behind write through, so that it creates a multiple, you can say traffic or memory traffic is created. There is another technique that is called as a write back. Okay. Write back says that updates are initially made in cache only. That means whenever we want to update, the updates are only allowable on cache only. Okay. For that, it maintains a update bit, or you can say it keeps a use bit or a dirty bit. We call it as a update bit for a cache slot is set when update occurs. So on a particular cache line, when update occurs, that cache line's update bit is set. Now, if a block is to be replaced, write to main memory only if update bit is set. That means suppose we want to replace a particular cache line, then we will see its update bit, or we will see its you can say dirty bit. If that dirty bit or update bit is set, then we need to first write out that cache line onto the main memory block, and then only we can perform the replacement of that cache line. Okay. That idea is implemented by the write back, and in that manner it reduces the memory writes. Okay. But the problem with the write back is that other caches get out of sync. That means whenever you have a multiple CPU architecture and every CPU has its own cache, then the write back happens to the main memory and with a particular cache from the particular CPU. But what about the another CPU? If that cache line is there in another cache of another CPU, then its entry will be invalid. Okay. So in that case, it creates a bottleneck that other CPU's cache entry of the same line will become invalidated because the write operation happens only on main memory and not on the other caches. So that is the problem with the write back. Okay. Now, it says IO must access main memory through the cache. That is another problem, that particular, as we have discussed, that input output device can have a direct access to main memory. Okay. So if the IO should get a updated copy, then it has to go through the cache. It cannot directly access the main memory block. It has to go to the cache line, and access is made available from the cache line. But this creates a complex circuitry if we do if we implement the write back policy with the help of input output devices. Now result says that 15% of memory references are writes for a general operations, that whatever memory references are happens that are 15% of writes, If you go for high performance computing system, then it increases that memory writes increases up to 33% and even more than 50% for you can say a superscalar kind of architecture or another high performance computing systems. So that is a write policy that performing write onto the cache is not an easy task. We have to see the different aspects, whether the copy of that line is replicated into other caches also or in main memory also. Okay, so that is about write policy. Now we'll see another design issue, that is line size. Okay, what will be the block or cache line size? Now, according to the principle of locality, what happens when a particular desired word is retrieved? Not only that word is retrieved, but along with that word, some adjacent words are also retrieved. So retrieve not only the desired word, but a number of adjacent words as well. Okay. So the issue here is that what should be the line size? What should be the line size of the cache? It should be a bigger, it should be smaller, or it should be larger. Okay. Increased block size will increase hit ratio at first, according to the principle of locality. Assume that there is no data into the cache and a particular word is referenced. So we have to bring that block from the main memory to the cache memory. Okay. And if you have a bigger line size or a block size, then many words or many adjacent words are brought into the cache. So at initially, according to the principle of locality, that many hit ratio or hit ratio will increase. Okay. Because the next word that we desired is already in the cache. According to the increased block size, we have brought many more words into the cache. So the word that has currently referenced is already there in cache, and the word that is next used by the CPU might be there in the cache and it will have a hit. So increased block size will increase hit ratio at first. At first it will increase, but hit ratio will decrease as the block becomes even bigger. If you try to increase the size or line size or block size even more bigger than that, then initially you will find that it will getting the hits, but at the afterwards the hit ratio will decrease, since the probability of using newly fetched information becomes less than the probability of reusing replaced. That means whatever information you have brought initially into the cache, that has been used now. Okay, so it is have a hit ratio, it is used. But next time when you want to refer, then the data which you are referring is not there into the cache memory. So you have to brought the another block from the main memory to the cache. Okay, the idea here is that why the hit ratio will decrease, because when you bring a particular words, then the word which is far from the currently referenced word is not required actually, according to the principle of locality. That means the word will not be in the vicinity of the near future, so the hit ratio will decrease. Okay, now due to the larger blocks, what happens? It reduces the number of blocks that fit into the cache. Okay, so in cache you have less number of cache lines due to the larger block size. Data overwritten shortly after being fetched. Okay, once you bring a block from the main memory to the cache memory, and due to the larger block size, suppose CPU refers to the word that is not in the vicinity of the block which you have just fetched, then it has to bring another block where that word resides from the main memory to the cache memory. That's why data overwritten shortly after being fetched. Each additional word is less local, so less likely to be needed. That means once you increase the block size, each additional word that is added to the into the block size is less local. That is, it is in the less vicinity of that current word, so it is less likely to be needed. So it is not required actually, and unnecessarily we are bringing those words into the cache. Now for this line size, no definitive optimum value has been found. It says that we cannot say that a line size should be of this much. It should be 16 bytes, 32 bytes, or 64 bytes. There is no definitive optimum value has been found because it depends on the programs that are executed by the CPU. Okay, whether the programs have the words that are referenced in a near vicinity of the current word, or whether the program is written in a different manner where the words that are referenced in the near future are distributed over the long distance in a program. So there will be no definitive optimum value. Okay. 8 to 64 bytes seems reasonable. That means for general purpose, 8 to 64 bytes line size is desirable. Okay. Another issue with this is that the line size of the different caches should be of the same size. Whenever you are using multi-level caches, then from multi-level caches, the line size of, say, level 1 should match with the line size of level 2. That is another issue. If we talk about high-performing systems, that is high-performance computing system, HPC systems, then it uses 64 and 128 bytes are most common for them. Okay, due to the pipelining architecture. Okay. So this is the issue that talks about the line size. That is one of the elements of cache design that designers have to think about what should be the line size or what should be the block size of the main memory. Okay. Next design issue is about the number of caches, you can say. Here the topic says unified versus split cache. But before this, we will discuss about multi-level caches. That why there are multiple levels of cache that we are talking about, the reason why L1, L2, L3, why there is not a single cache. Okay. So first we'll discuss that and then we'll come back to this topic, that is unified versus split cache. Now, why there are multi-level cache? At first, when cache is introduced, there is only single cache. In one CPU, there is only one cache, okay? And that cache is on chip. Okay, that means it is on the CPU's chip so that the access can be faster, okay? But the size of that cache is limited due to the space, because we cannot fit many more cache of bigger size onto the chip because the chip area is smaller. And cache is made up of the SRAM, and we know that SRAM a single bit of SRAM requires 6 transistors, so it requires a more space. Okay, so why there are multi-level caches? Now suppose you have a single cache and that single cache gets filled, then CPU refers to a word that is not there in cache, then it has to go to the slowest memory, that is the main memory or ROM, and it has to bring that word from there. That means that word should be copied to the cache and then it is accessible to the CPU. So the CPU performance gets degraded. That's why the idea came that another cache level, that is we call it as a L2 cache, should be incorporated into the architecture. So L2 cache, initially when L2 cache came in picture, it is external. That means it is not on chip. So L2 cache can be accessed through either the system bus, but the designer have decided that for accessing L2 cache, that means access from the CPU to the L2 cache, they use a separate data line so that the system bus is free to do another task, so that the burden should not come over the system bus. So a separate data line is kept between CPU and the L2 cache. Okay. Due to this, there can be a faster access. You can say with a zero wait cycle, the data can be accessed with the cache. Another thing is that the hit ratio that we are talking about is considered together from L1 or L2 cache. That means if you found your data or instruction in L1 cache, or if you found your data or instruction from L2 cache, it is considered as a hit. Okay. So initially, a level 2 is attached or it is included in the architecture and it is an external. But as the advancement has happened and density of fitting the chips or density of the components on the processor that is increasing, due to that, components become smaller and a more cheap area is available to fit the level 2 cache onto the chip. So the some designs came up with the idea that L2 cache should also be on chip. So now the L2 cache becomes on chip so that the access gets faster. Okay. Then another idea come. Why cannot be there will be another cache that can be kept as external. Then L3 came in picture. So L3 level 3 cache kept as an external and L1 and L2 cache are on chip. Okay. And this kind of architecture. Now, why these are different levels of cache? Because if the data which you have found in L1 and L2 cache, if it is not found in L1 and L2 cache, then again it has to go to the main memory. So that's why a faster memory, that is SRAM memory, is level 3 cache is added. Okay. Another issue is that in this level 1, level 2 and level 3 caches, the size of the cache, that is the size of the next level of the cache should be double the previous one. Otherwise, it will have the same data. That means, suppose L1 is of 64 KB and L2 is of also 64 KB, then L2 will have a replicated data or L2 will have a mirror image of kind of L1, more or less mirror image of the L1. So that's why the size of the L2 should be double or more than the double of L1 cache. So if your L1 cache is of 16 KB, then L2 cache should be of 32 KB and the L3 cache should be of 64 KB and more. Okay. So that is about different levels of caches, that why we require a different levels of caches. Okay. Since we require a data access faster, that's why we have a different levels of caches. Now, coming back to the unified versus split caches. Now, unified means there will be only a single cache that previously we are using, that when cache came in picture, there is only one cache, one CPU with one on-chip cache, that is called as a unified cache. And split caches, unified in the sense, the data, that is data and instructions are stored in one cache only. And split caches means there will be a separate data cache and there will be a separate instruction cache, but at the same level. So if you are talking about level one, then at the level one, you have a different data cache and at the same level, you will have an instruction cache. So that is called as a split caches. Now, one cache for data and instructions or two. That means one cache in which data and instructions resides, or you have two separate cache, one for data and one for instruction. That is unified and split caches. Now, what are the advantages of unified cache? If we are using a single cache, then what are its advantages? It has a higher hit rate. Okay. Why it has a higher hit rate than split caches? Because it balances the load of instruction and data fetch. Consider that a particular program where you have more instructions than the data, then the balancing can be done. That means whatever word you brought into the cache will be of instructions, more number of instructions than the data. Okay. And suppose in particular program, you have more data and code is smaller, then there will be more data lines in a cache than the instruction. So balance will be made and accordingly the hit ratio will be increased. Only one cache to design and implement. So simple architecture, you have to design only one cache. So implementation is easier. Okay. So that are the advantages of unified cache. But even after this kind of advantages, we go for a split cache. So the advantages of split cache, where unified cache fails, there will be a contention. Suppose you have the split cache is used in pipelining architecture or superscalar architecture. Suppose you have instruction fetch and decode unit. You know the different instruction cycles. You have instruction fetch, instruction decode, then execute, and write back. Such kind of phases are there in instruction cycle. Suppose a particular execution unit requires to access a data. Okay, so that will be provided with the, if we consider the example of unified cache, then this unified cache is providing data to the execution unit. And at the same time, a particular program requires a instruction fetch. Okay, due to the simultaneous execution, it requires instruction fetch at the same time. But there will be a contention because that cache is providing data to the execution unit. So same cache or unified cache or a single cache cannot be given access to the instruction fetch unit. So instruction fetch unit has to wait. So that is called as a contention due to the unified cache. So that disadvantage is overcome with the help of a split cache. It eliminates the cache contention between instruction fetch or decode unit and execution unit, which is important in pipelining. So at the same time, if a execution units require the data, then that can be given from the data cache. And if instruction fetch or decode unit requires a instruction, then it can be given from the instruction cache. So the simultaneous execution can be done. So that is unified versus split caches. Okay. So this issue talks about the number of caches, that how many caches you can maintain at level 1, level 2, level 3, why there is a requirement for different levels of caches, and another unified versus split cache. What is the importance of unified cache and why we require split caches? There is another issue that we have discussed the starting, that is write policy. The write policy, we have seen two implementation, that is write through and write back. But both these write through and write back have a disadvantage, that when they have a multiple caches, then the update cannot happen into the multiple CPU caches. The system that maintains updates everywhere, that is in different caches and in main memory also, then that system is said to have a cache coherent, or that system is maintaining cache coherency. This topic is discussed in the next slides. Okay. Thank you. We'll stop here. Have a good day.